Whiddon-Rogers, and I would like to know, what do you do in this community?
Oh, sure. Well, I am the mayor of Broward County. My name is Barbara Sharief, and I'm a District 8 Broward County Commissioner, and I'm serving as mayor this year. And what's historic about that is that I'm the first African-American female mayor in Broward County in 99 years.
I'm in 12th grade, and I want to know, what do you do for our community?
What do I do?
In our community.
Right now, I'm the police chief for the city of Fort Lauderdale.
My name is Brianna Haptime with Rec News.
Okay.
And I would like to know, what do you do for our community?
What do I do for the community? Our community? Well, I'm a lawyer here in Fort Lauderdale, born and raised in Fort Lauderdale.
Mm-hmm.
I've served in many capacities. Right now, I'm the president of Florida Bar.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm all over this community and over the state, speaking and serving in all sorts of capacities.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
My name is Brianna Hampton. I am with WRIC News, and I'd like to know, what do you do for our community?
Good morning, I'm Dr. Roslind Osgood. I serve our community in various capacities. I'm the president and CEO of the Mount Olive Development Corporation, which is the faith-based community development arm of the New Mount Olive Baptist Church.
Our guest speakers that we have today have made incredible strides and impacts in their chosen professions. Each are basically a living history story. Being the first African-Americans to reach the pinnacles of their career fields. Whiddon-Rogers Educational Center are extremely gratified that these individuals have taken the time out to share their talents and their experiences with our students and staff. And thank you for that.
It's indeed a pleasure to be here with you this morning. We were eating breakfast a little early, and I was trying to have a drink reflection and capture this moment. And I told Dr. Osgood and the mayor and the chief, I said, we started from the bottom, now we're here. And Dr. Osgood, who I think listens to a little more radio than I do, she said, now my whole team's here. But truly, it's a blessing to be here with you all. This has a special meaning in my life. As some of you may know, because I spoke here about a year ago, I went to Rogers Middle School, the same building, and walked many of these same hallways. And to come back here some 40 odd years later, it doesn't seem that long, but to come back here some 40 odd years later, and to look in you all's faces, all I see is the possibility of what the future holds for each of you. And all honesty, because I can go back to the beginning. You see who I am now, but I wasn't always, straight and proper. When I was here at Rogers, I had some troubled times. I was speaking with Mr. Newton earlier. Andre and I went to Rogers when we were just busing, just desegregating, and there were tough times coming out here. I remember fighting every day getting off the school bus because it was the first time that black students were being bused out into predominantly white schools. You would have to get off the bus and kids were calling you names and derogatory comments. And that was a real troubling time. And if I would have stopped the movie right there, there was no way you could have perceived that I would be where I am today. And that's why I can look in your eyes and see there's all sorts of hope and potential for your life, because I walked those paths. I grew up here in Fort Lauderdale, as we say, 3311. And it's not so much where you started in life, it's where you end up.
Much, and it is just a pleasure and honor to be here with you today. Most of the time, all we hear about is all of the negative statistics about the 3311. But today, you get a chance to see that there are some great things that come out of the 33311. As I was sitting here reflecting and listening at Attorney Pettis and just thinking about my life, I think I was different all of my life. I was a young, very tall, skinny, undesirable child who was just really dumb. I didn't learn to read until the end of third grade. I remember being bullied a lot by kids because I was so undesirable. I kept trying. I lived in a neighborhood which was predominant with guys, so I began to go to the park and learn how to play basketball with the guys. And when you learn how to play ball with the guys, when you go to school with the girls, you have an edge up because the guys play a lot harder. I ended up getting around eighth grade and beginning to experiment with marijuana and drugs, and ultimately going to college, getting pregnant, dropping out, and literally ended up on the streets homeless 24 years ago, battling with substance and alcohol. But we are writing our stories. You're writing your history right now. And you're in charge of what it's going to say or how it's going to turn out. I've always been different. I've been able to be a trailblazer in many ways. I'm the first woman in the history of our church to be licensed and ordained to preach and position in the pulpit. God blessed me this year to be the first female to be a chaplain for the City of Fort Lauderdale Police Department, which is another new experience. And remember, I told you I was battling on the streets with drugs and alcohol, and from that I was arrested 2 times and have 2 felony convictions. But I have a badge and a card that gives me access to the police department. And I say that for that person who is sitting here today, and you're hearing and you're seeing us, but in your mind, you're at that difficult and challenging place where you've made a multiplicity of bad choices and bad decisions, some things that will stick with you for the rest of your life. And you're struggling and you're challenged, or maybe you're that young person that's sitting here today and your mother or father's like I was, going in and out of jail, strung out on drugs and alcohol. I say, and I say what I'm saying to you because I want you to see that if my life can be transformed and changed, so can yours.
I started over. I called the state. I said, I need some exceptions made because they had about $14 million in outstanding account receivables that they couldn't collect, but I knew I could collect it. I just need to fix it. So I told the state, look, I need some exceptions, I need some time, and I started fixing. 2 weeks later, like, I fired everybody except the secretary, so I figured I could train her. The rest of them I let go. Collected about $4 million, and they were coming down, they gave me my first paycheck. And I thought, you know, if I collect $4 million, these people are gonna give me much more than what my hourly rate is, right? I got my first paycheck and it was just that, my first paycheck. So I went and collected another $4 or $5 million, and after I'd been there for about a month, I realized, I said, boy, I'm doing something that they couldn't do, and they're just not paying me. So I put in a resignation letter and I said, I'm leaving. They said, what? I said, yeah, because you're not paying me what I'm worth, and I've already proven myself to you, so what are you gonna do for me to stay here? They said, we'll give you 6 figures. So my salary went up, and I got 6 figures, plus I got a bonus on everything that I collected. And then they came a few months later after I had settled into my nice paycheck and my salary and my desk and my new office, and they said, hey, we need to know if you're willing to fly all over the United States and do this at the other 109 locations. So I said, okay, sure, why not? So that started my travels on to the 109 locations. They called me a location analyst, but when I got to Kentucky, North Carolina, and Georgia, they called me a whole bunch of other stuff that began with N and ended with the R. Anyway, by the time we finished with that, I did that for 3 years, and then I decided that I wanted to work for myself. So I opened up a home health care company. It's called South Florida Pediatric Home Care. And at present, that was 13 years ago when I opened that company. And right now, we employ just over 600 professionals in Dayton, Broward County. So that's how I got to into politics, because that company affords me the opportunity to have the time to help other people. I have a business which everything in local government and politics affects. I didn't like what was happening in terms of leadership in politics, so I'm not one to sit back and complain. I'm an action-oriented person, so I like to do something. So don't ever be one of those people that just sit back and complain,
right,
or wait for a handout, right, or wait for somebody to make their best.
Greetings from the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People, the NAACP. As I said, I'm the president here in our local branch. I also serve the state organization, the Florida State Conference, as its treasurer and health chair. My journey actually began here in Fort Lauderdale. I didn't grow up here, but I was born here in the 33311 frame. And, Dr. Osgood, I came from a family whose mom wasn't quite ready to be a parent yet. And so I was forced to go live in a very rural town in Georgia, where when I say we were poor, I wish it was a joke, but it was not, where there was no running water, where people still live like this today. It's not what you see on television. My father went to live in one of those gated communities. As a matter of fact, he's still there. And so when you talk about not having parents, that being the Huxtables on television, that was me. When you talk about not having monies, that was me. When you talk about having probably one person, my grandmother, who loved me unconditionally in the whole world, that was me. And she was everything to me. And she always taught me, she always say, you know, you don't have much, what you have is yours. Two things I can't stand, Marsha, is a thief and a liar. I heard that every day of my whole life. So whatever we had was ours. So going without was something that we were used to. In this little town, blacks lived on one side of the town, whites lived on the other, and rarely did the two mix. The N-word was a common thing. You know, there were certain places you could work and not a lot of commerce, but there it was. But that was never an excuse to do anything but live better. I always knew that that was not for me. The NAACP has allowed me an opportunity to work with other people, to work with other organizations, to meet people from all over the world. It has allowed me to put together programs. It has allowed me to help folk who don't have their voice yet, but good people. It has allowed me to work with your school district to put into the Promise Program. It has allowed me to put together a juvenile diversion program for those kids who may have made a mistake, but who among us have not made a mistake?
All right.
And so when mistakes are made, you shouldn't be punished forever. Everybody deserves a second chance. So I said to the state attorney's office, if you allow me and the NAACP to work with these young people, we will give them a second chance, and I'll stand in the gap and say that if you allow them a second chance, they will do better. Those children, as I worked through the NAACP, I saw children as young as 8 who were arrested for things that, juvenile behavior. The chances are, Chief, if they look, they might find you might have been in a fight or two back in the back of Strand and I knew that if I put my mind to it, no one could stop me from doing anything. And I still believe that as a president of the NAACP. So even though it's not popular, oftentimes I take positions that are not, it's all right. As long as you know you're doing the right thing, everything will be fine. So thank you so much for your time.
I began right here, Rogers Middle School. It wasn't Whiddon-Rogers then. I don't know where Whiddon came from. You know, it's good when you come in and you listen to people speak on panels because, you know, Gene Pettis and I grew up together. And we're products of the 33311, just like Andre Newton, who, how many people have been in that situation where they said, it's all over for me, I'm failing, and they completely turned it around. Yeah. She has a powerful message. And Mayor, when you said you're not cool, I get to tell you. The nurse at age 15, now have over 600 people employed by you, and you've been doing such a great job running our county. I got to tell you, you are one cool female. I got nothing but great things to say about our president of the NAACP. I'm the police. She's the NAACP. And when you look at history, especially during this month, Black history, you saw police against the NAACP. When you look at the history of the city of Fort Lauderdale, police against the NAACP. 3 years ago, who stood at the beach, Los Olos and A1A, celebrating blacks being able to swim in the ocean. And today, we got one of the best working relationships in our city is with the NAACP. Our president came to me and says, I want to do juvenile citation. I want to do this program. Well, all these other chiefs in county, Broward County says, we're not really sure we want to do that and give up our discretion. Why? Because they don't face the same issues that we have in Fort Lauderdale.
Here, here.
I was on board.
First one.
And when the president came and says, we need you to support promise and all the great things that we think that's going to happen on promise, I raised my hand. I said, we're on board.
First one. And the
superintendent, I mean, he has a vision here, something that we didn't have in the past. Because we need to take care of our kids before they become the repeat offender. In a lot of different neighborhoods, they have different issues. You know, when they see a young kid that get arrested for prowling in a city like Lighthouse Point, don't live there, they come to get arrested for prowling. Do you know the officer that makes that arrest is probably their officer of the year? Because nothing really exciting happened. Well, exciting in the sense of bad things. And that's it. So that's a big deal for them. But for me, we have kids that are in the revolving door. We're trying to shut the door. We don't want to continue to arrest them for burglary and robbery. We're trying to get them on the right track. And it's partnerships that we have. And we continue to work on to make these things happen, to make it a better future for those individuals. You know, I stand here, I'm a proud product of the 33311. My father had a different kind of view. He was a very strong man. He came from an area where you never back down from anything. Fear no other man but Jesus Christ. He trusted and believed in the Lord Jesus Christ, and he told us that every day. There's no man other than the Lord Jesus Christ that's stronger than you. And he never allowed in our neighborhood people to stand out in front of our yard selling drugs. We live right across the street from one of the well-known transit homes in the city of Fort Lauderdale, Pinkies, on 15th Way. I grew up right across the street. He had a different outlook with the police. He realized that some were bad because living in Northwest Fort Lauderdale, we had people that wore this uniform and came and did some things that were just totally, totally wrong. And then you had this other group like the San Vitros that says, I'm going to take you home. So he had a pretty objective view. But you know, I came on the police department 34 years ago. The old friends that I met over the years and the people that came before me, who definitely took interest in me and mentored me and helped me to be what I am today. But 34 years ago was a different environment for us. But it was people like McKinley Smith and Robert Ingram and the late Doug Evans that really took an interest in me and helped me. They were the ones that actually paved the way for all of the black officers in Fort Lauderdale because it was a different day. It was just funny, you know how you get up to speak and you have a certain message you want to say, and then all of a sudden you just go a different direction. And it dawned on me the other night, never in my wildest dreams that I would have thought 34 years ago that we would have a black police chief, a black assistant chief, a black major, and a black captain, all in charge of the 33311. They have these detectives. None of them look like us. Coming to this scene, no one would talk to them. No one would give them any information. But I would get a call. And my mother would say to me,
call such and such because he wants to talk to you. And when I get on the phone, I know who did the homicide, I know where the gun is, and I know four or five people that witnessed it. So I would go to the station and I write up these supplement reports. And I say, this is where you need to go. This is where the gun is. So all of these detectives will be like, who is this person? We never heard of this guy. Rookie guy, saw the homicides. You gotta be kidding me. But if you're from the 33311 and you know everyone, you can do this. You know what I mean? You can be the superstar patrolman because everyone's gonna talk to you. You know exactly what I'm talking about. They're gonna come to you, they're gonna talk to you because they feel comfortable with you. And that's the thing that I had that many other police officers didn't. I had to trust in the people because I am a part of that group. So who are you gonna talk to? We really don't want these homicides in our neighborhood. We got to pick the guy that we're gonna go to. And they picked me. If there's one thing, my message to you is never be afraid to fail. Because when you look at Black history and the people that did the amazing things to give us the freedom that we have today, if they would have failed once, we'd probably still be in a struggle. They continue to work and we're free today. Thank you and may God bless you.
We got the Black mayor. You know what I'm saying? We got Black police. And we still got the NAACP doing what they already done under Mr. Ellison's leadership. That is why we are successful. And there's nothing more important than the vision of our principal. He puts pressure on all of us. He wants the best of all of you. And so do the rest of our staff. All of the teachers in here, please raise your hand. They work hard every day for you to be successful. So I'm gonna close it out. I'm gonna close it out, and I just wanna let you know that I appreciate you, but the one thing that they didn't tell us about from the old days is this. Without love, it can't happen. Everything starts with love and prayer. Have a good day.